Welcome to Trial Site News Podcast. We are excited to have our next guest, Jennifer Dredge, via phone, discussing her experience with ankylosing spondylitis, an autoimmune or auto-inflammatory disease, depending on who you talk to. Now, Jen is a patient who has been suffering from AS for 11 years. She's a mother of a beautiful 2-year-old daughter and works in the healthcare industry. So, Jen, welcome.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Oh, we're excited to have you here. Now, Jennifer, for our listeners who might not be as familiar with what AS is, can you give us an overview of what AS is all about?
Sure. Depending on who you talk to, it's either autoinflammatory or autoimmune. Mm-hmm. Most people I speak with, or most doctors I've seen, et cetera, it's inflammatory. So it's a disease that over time can cause your vertebrae or, usually it's vertebrae, but it can kind of go to other areas in your spine to fuse, and it makes your spine, so it's not flexible, right? So, and a lot of people actually kind of get a curved deal to their back, moving them forward. Yeah, and it also is very painful when it's flaring. You really can't move very well. There's chronic conditions with it. And if it's fusing, you're in trouble because it doesn't unfuse. Once it's fused, it fuses.
So it's a permanent change.
Yeah, it can be a permanent deal. And it can lead to a lot of other things that people don't think about. And even doctors, when you go see rheumatologists, things like that, they don't always tell you about some of the other things that could come along with ankylosing, because it can actually affect your rib cage and some other areas where it can start to press on or interfere with organs. Mm-hmm. So some AS patients can't breathe properly. There's heart conditions that can be linked to it. So it's a lot more far-reaching than people would know. Does that make sense?
It does. Now, I've heard that getting diagnosed with ankylosing spondylitis can be really difficult. Can you tell us about how and when you were diagnosed?
Yes. A lot of doctors, at least in the past, and I think it's progressively getting better, but in the past, it was just assumed it's a arthritis. I mean, and it is an arthritis, but they kind of lump it in with rheumatoid arthritis. It gets lumped in with rheumatoid arthritis all the time, or misdiagnosed in that area. And sometimes they'll test for a certain HLB, I think it's HLB 27. Mm-hmm. They'll test for that, to see, and that can sometimes give them an idea if it's HLA-B 27. And that can give them an idea if it's AS or not. But again, it doesn't confirm it, because there are some AS patients who have HLA-B27 positive and some who are negative. Oh. So it's a confusing, it's hard to diagnose. So what happened with me was I was at work one day, and a fellow employee came to work with pink eye. And again, who knows, this was just the trigger for it, right? It was probably it was dormant or kind of hiding out in my body, and this triggered it. She came to work with pink eye. I got pink eye from her. And within, I'd say, probably 4 hours, my eye was to the point where I couldn't, it would not dilate. So anytime it had tried to move or dilate, it was like kind of tearing at itself.
Oh,
so
wow.
Iritis, uveitis, those are kind of the first signs for a lot of AS patients. So it's again, confusing because it's in your eye. So if you're a patient and you don't know anything about AS, you're thinking you're having a problem with your eye, right? Not
right.
Your spine, not anything like that. So that's how it showed up first for me. By the time I got home, I was in so much pain that, we rushed over to an eye doctor. He looked at it. He gave me some things to put in it. I don't remember what it was at the time, but he gave me some eye drops. Those didn't work for a few days. And by the point after those, I think it was like 2 or 3 days, I was in so much pain. I remember grabbing my door frame and just squeezing it with both hands because I was in so much pain. I couldn't function. So we then called the Imoran Center in Utah, mm-hmm. and Dr. Ambadi was who saw me. And I went in to see him. He's a specialist, really great eye doctor or ophthalmologist.
Yeah.
Went in to see him, and within, he looked at my eye, and within, I don't know, maybe five minutes, he was like, I'm pretty sure this is AS, but I need to do some more tests, but I'm pretty sure this is AS. And of course, I'm like, what is AS? What are you talking about?
Right.
And he you know, so he told me the name of it, and I'm like, whoa, that's kind of a scary name, and I don't know what that means. And so he explained to me, and he's like, we've got to run some tests. And one of the tests he did is that HLA B27. And I came back, you know, with that gene, and it was, you know, it was active. So I came back with that, and he did a few other things, you know, as far as sent me to a rheumatologist, had my back scanned, all of these other deals. And yeah, we confirmed it's AS. Now that was, like you said, 11 years ago. I was young, didn't think much of it. Once the eye deal cleared up, I was like, I'm good to go. I don't feel anything. I'm fine. I'm scot-free, right?
Right, just so, staying away from pink eye from now on, yes.
Yeah, staying away from pink eye. He did tell me never to, you know, or not never, but if I could avoid injuring that eye, that would be good. He gave me some drops. He told me to keep those drops with me at all times in case it ever flared again. I needed to get those drops in immediately, you know, to get it under control, which I did, by the way. I did carry those drops with me. I'd go get it renewed, you know, et cetera. I always had those drops with me, and he was right. Every now and then, like, and I'd move to different states. Every now and then, very rarely, I'd get a little pain in that eye, you know, and it'd twitch, and kind of, I could tell when it was coming on. So I put a drop in, we were good to go. And that was
gotcha.
It. And that's, yeah. So, and that's how I got the diagnosis.
Gotcha. And now, how did things evolve with your condition?
So, like I said earlier, I didn't take it seriously. Like, I didn't fully comprehend what I had just been diagnosed with. And I was young, and I wasn't feeling anything in my back. I'm good to go. As things evolved, I did start having some pain in my back, but it wasn't enough that I even noticed. You know what I mean? Like, when you get up in the morning, and you're like, oh, I got a little pain in my back. I'm good.
Right. Who doesn't have back pain? Sure. Right.
Right. Exactly. And the rest of the day, I'm fine. Like, no problems. I mean, I was a runner in New Orleans. I did all sorts of activities. There was, you know, no problem. I'm good to go. And then fast forward, I moved back to my home state, Utah, and a different autoimmune issue started. And then they put me on Humira for that issue. And it was crazy because all of a sudden I woke up one morning and I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't have any back pain. Like, I did not understand, because I'd lived with it so long, what the difference was. And it was a very stark difference. You know what I mean? I was like, holy moly, I can move my full back. I don't hurt in the top part or the lower part of the spine. Like, this is crazy. I've got movement, you know, so I was kind of like, whoa. That was a wake-up call, and that was the first wake-up call for me of how it had actually been progressing, and I didn't realize it, right?
Right.
And then I got pregnant with my child. They went to do the epidural. I chose to have an epidural. They went to do that, and the gentleman, I had told the specialist before he did it, I said, I have AS. I've never, you know, had it really checked out after I first got diagnosed because I didn't realize I was feeling any effects from it, so I don't know how my spine is. In other words, be careful, you might be hitting, you know, some fusion. I don't know.
Right.
So he did the epidural, and he told me, he was great. He was like, you're actually at about an 80%, so you're doing really well considering how long you've had it. And that was great. And I had my baby, and I thought everything would be fine. And unfortunately for me, I had preeclampsia that went undiagnosed. And because of that, my blood pressure got to a level that was scary, and I had to be admitted to the ER 3 days after they'd released me from the hospital with my baby. So I had to be readmitted to the hospital, but I was in the ER. And then I was there for 3 days. And in those 3 days, you know, they have to give you a magnesium drip. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, I felt that pressure. And then my eye started to absolutely wig out, is the best way I can describe it. You know, it was pulsing pain. There's red. And I'm like, it's off to the races, you know, the iritis is back, you know, so I immediately got the drops again, put them in, we got that, you know, under control, but it took longer this time than it ever had in the past, right? It took longer for it to get under control, and I was like, oh dear, oh no, I think AS is now in a full flare, where I think before I'd had little moments of flare, and then it'd go into almost remission, right, or just calm or dormant, and I have, since I've had my child, so she's two, I have been in a full AS flare. It has not stopped. Yeah. So It hasn't gotten, I wouldn't say it's got, there are people who have it far worse as far as their flares go, right? They're in, I mean, I can function. I can go to work. I can function. But I cannot stand for more than an hour. If I stand for more than an hour, I'm in terrible pain. The back part of my, the lower back, I can't function. So that's kind of how it evolved.
Wow, that's awful. So you said that it's in full flare. So I was going to ask, how often does it flare? But is it just a constant flare up, or is it just that it's active and it's...
It's constant active for me. It's not, it never goes like higher or lower, right? You know, for the past 2 years, it's been a constant. I am very well aware of my back pain. There are some times when I can't breathe at night very well. Because the pain is so intense and because it's very active.
And then medications, you mentioned Humira. Have you tried, other than that, has anything helped with your AS, or what have you tried to control the flare-ups?
So like I said, Humira worked for that, and again, it was to be used for something else. The problem for me with Humira is I suffered severe side effects from it, so I had to go off of it. So for me, what I have noticed that will help with AS is you have to stay active. It's very hard to do so. Like I said, it's very painful, but you've got to stretch your back out every morning. I get up every morning and stretch my back out. So yoga, you know, things like that where you're stretching the back is really good. It sounds kind of opposite of what you should do, you know, you think, but really you've got to keep it active. The other thing that, you know, helps AS, I have found, because I've fluctuated in my weight and stuff like that. If I'm at a little bit lower weight, that helps, because it can kind of spread to knees, can kind of go other places if there's extra weight. So that, and then a anti-inflammatory diet. The anti-inflammatory diet has been the best thing for both my autoimmune or auto-inflammatory issues, whichever ones you want to call them. So that's... For me, no dairy. I absolutely cannot have dairy. I cannot have potatoes, tomatoes. Sugar, obviously, is very bad for it. And actually, if I eat sugar, so not fruit, but sugar, if I eat like a cake or a cookie or something, I immediately feel it in my back. My back reacts immediately. So, you know, there's just certain things you have to be aware of and you can't eat. You know, if you want to have true kind of remission or have it kind of calm down, I think food is a big factor for a lot of people, not everyone, right? The hormones can be play, stress definitely plays in, things like that. But food has been, I would say, the biggest key for my AS, and then, of course, stretching out my back.
Right. So speaking of, what triggers your AS?
So mine was obviously ultimately triggered by, I think, the high blood pressure and probably the epidural, you know, the stress of the situation originally. Nowadays, like I said, if I eat certain foods, I can feel the response immediately. The other thing that triggers it is if I do have to stand for a large amount of time during the day, then I'm in bad shape. Or simple things. Like what people, I think, kind of take for granted every day, I did before it was really bad for me. Cleaning your house, for example. You know, you're bending over, you're moving stuff. If I do a day of cleaning, I'm in bed the next day. Like, I'm in bed. So, you know, it can just be simple things like that, unfortunately. Hormones don't seem to affect my AS too much. Those don't seem to be. They affect my other autoimmune, but AS, it doesn't really seem to tie in for me. So I would say stressful movements or standing for a long period of time, those kinds of things activate my AS.
Now, shifting gears a little bit, let's move it over to the doctors and your medical care. What has been your experience so far with your doctors and with your overall medical care?
So Doctor on Body and even the initial eye doctor were great. You know, they really were great. I was very lucky because, like I said, a lot of people don't get diagnosed right away. I was. Mine was really quick. Dr. Onbody knew exactly what was happening. I was really, really lucky. He's been fabulous. My new rheumatologist that I go to is great. And he's been very, what I found nice about my new rheumatologist is some of my previous experience with rheumatologists is when I'd bring up food or things like that, it was kind of more like, no, we're going to put you on a biologic. Remicade, Humira, whatever, right?
Right.
Something. And this new one, the very first time I met him, I went through my history and everything, and I said, I really want to try to focus on keeping it in remission with food and activity, if possible, because my reaction was so severe to Humira. Like I said, I had some bad side effects.
Right.
So I was like, I'd rather try to do it this way, if we can. And instead of almost arguing with me or kind of almost saying that I'm not going to treat you, because I've had that happen before.
Oh, wow.
He was like, yeah, let's try, you know, yeah, he was great. He's like, let's, you know, try this. And he, of course, advised to take turmeric supplements, things like that. So he's been really great in that he's listening to me. And as long as my markers, I forget what they call them, but they're your inflammatory markers. They do tests on them.
Mm-hmm.
As long as those stay within a certain range, and same with my white blood cell count, all that. As long as those stay within a certain range, then he's fine with, you know what I mean, the food
right.
angle of it. So I have been really lucky. I know a lot of people have not. A lot of people, you know, like I said, don't get diagnosed properly or are kind of told what I was with some of those others, which is I'm not going to work with you if you don't do it my way.
Right. Well, and you got referred to a rheumatologist right quick, which is amazing.
Yes, it is, because that is actually a good point. A lot of people, A, if they are referred, have to wait months to be seen by one. And B, it's amazing how many rheumatologists won't accept you. Like, they just tell you, no, we're not going to see you. We're busy. We're whatever.
Oh,
so,
wow.
Yeah, I was very lucky that way.
So speaking of, did you feel for you personally that there was compassion and understanding about your autoimmune issue within the healthcare professionals that you saw?
So I did with Dr. Onbody. Again, some of the other ones, no. I don't actually blame the doctors per se. I think when you're seeing it every day, right?
Yeah.
You get desensitized or removed from the pain that your patient actually is in. Right. You see it every day. It's not, you know, and some people, like, again, I don't think it's completely the doctor's fault. If you're advising people on things to take care of themselves and for example, losing weight, right? If you're a doctor and you have to keep saying, really, this will help you, and your patients will not take that advice, right? Or they want to take it. They just can't make those life changes, right? It's really hard. It's a difficult move.
Yep.
I think you get kind of almost bitter about it. You know, you're like, well, then if you're not going to listen to what I'm saying, I'm not going to help you anymore. You know, and they don't take into consideration, again, that pain factor. The pain is acute. It's a very extreme pain. And because you cannot visually see it on a person, like most chronic pain issues, because you cannot physically see it on them, I don't think people understand the pain and that includes doctors. Because if you don't suffer it yourself, you almost have no way of comprehending the amount of pain that it is. And also how it affects people's personalities and emotions. So again, you're telling somebody to do this, this, or that. If they're in a deep depression, right? We've all had a bad day or a day where we're like, I can't even get out of bed, right? I'm depressed. I don't want to get out of bed. If you're in a certain amount of pain and you deal with it every day, it's really hard to get motivated to do some of these things.
Right.
And I think there needs to be more compassion on the healthcare side of understanding that and helping in that.
Yeah, that makes all kinds of sense. Now, what are some things that you have noticed in the AS community as a whole that can be triggers? And any recommendations of things for people to avoid?
Sure. We kind of touched on it a little bit earlier, but like I said, hormones, stress, life-changing events, that kind of goes back to stress. But I mean, I've seen a lot of people, for example, lose a loved one or divorce or things like that that are, you know, life-changing moments. And they, you know, all of a sudden it's triggered. It's off to the races, right? And then they cannot get it back into remission. Even as life calms down, they can't find a way to get it back. So yeah, the triggers, stress, hormones, food, all of those kinds of things. Inactivity, I think, is a trigger. And then the ways to put it, you know, are to kind of help get it under control. Like I said, food and activity, I would say, are some of the biggest for AS. And then trying to keep things as unstressful as possible, which I know is almost impossible nowadays. Yeah. But as much as possible, try not to get stressed out. But yeah, food and activity key.
Right, just live under a rock and everything will be good. And finally, if there was one piece of advice that you could give to all the doctors out there about AS and those suffering with this issue, what would it be?
I would say, again, go back and kind of try to put yourself in your patient's shoes for a minute, because, again, they see so many patients, they get desensitized to it. The pain is severe. And a lot of AS patients have been put on opioids for a long time, right, to help with pain, which we know can have all sorts of other issues and things of that nature. There are, of course, AS patients that are now suffering because of the crackdown on opioids and have no way of pain management. So it goes both directions, right?
Yep.
You have people who don't abuse it, who really need that for pain management, but you have people who abuse it. So it's a hard line to figure out. So I would say put yourself in their shoes for a minute. Understand that while they may not make these life changes that you've advised immediately, because there is depression, there is anxiety, there's all sorts of things that come with it that I think they've separated themselves from. Like, so just try to see it from your patient's point of view for a minute. Put yourself in their shoes, and if you had to live with this every single day, how would you feel? You know, what would you want someone to do for you? And I think listening. Listening is really key, because, again, you see it all day long. You're like, oh, I'm going to prescribe this, this, and this. That's what I always do. Well, not every patient's the same. And with autoimmune and autoinflammatory diseases, oh my goodness, no two people are the same. Like, it's all different things. And so I think you have to look at each patient as the individual and treat them as the individual they are, right? And form a game plan that way.
Yeah, rather than just looking at it as, oh, just someone new coming in through the door. No.
Yes. Well, yeah, I think they have a tendency to go, well, it's AS. This is what I always do for AS. This is what should always happen for AS. But it's not always just AS. There's also, as I'm sure anyone that has an autoimmune or autoinflammatory disease can tell you, if there's one, there's another one.
Yeah.
And maybe 3, 4, 5. Okay. They come in pairs or more, usually. It might take a few years for the second one to show up. So you have to really, you know, understand your patient. There are other things maybe going on that they don't even know about yet.
Right. And, you know, and we get that doctors are incredibly busy, and but that extra touch, you know, where it really makes a difference if you're each patient individually.
Correct. Yeah.
Gotcha. Well, Jen, thank you so much for talking with us today. It was enlightening to be able to talk to you about your AS experience, and we really appreciate your time with us.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I've appreciated it.
Yeah, it's our pleasure. Now, for those of you in the audience curious to learn more, you can do so by going to spondylitis.org, and there you'll find tons of information on this issue. And you can also find Trial Site News on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. And the links will be in the description below. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.